Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Zilch, The Power of Zero in Business by Nancy Lublin. Introduction. Recently, I was in a meeting at the offices of a ginormous global conglomerate. Eight of us sat around a big, beautiful table made of incredible wood, no doubt harvested from some disappearing rainforest. A fancy phone in the middle of the table linked us to voices from three other cities: the media buyer for the company, a rep from the creative firm, and a brand strategist. They served the most amazing oversized oatmeal cookies with white chocolate chips that were still warm, the sweet scent filling the room. We were discussing the launch of a new campaign, so the mood should have been corks popping celebratory. But just the day before, the corporation's media budget had been slashed. Everyone in the room was either dejected or in panic. The disembodied voices on the phone were mumbling mournfully to each other. The most practical thinkers in the room, I counted two, remained hopeful, searching for solutions to this annoying little problem of having zilch. Note, the advertising budget had been slashed to a mere $2 million. The top exec in the room, who was wearing a pair of handcrafted leather shoes so incredibly lovely that the left shoe alone could have been sold on eBay and fed a family of six in Rwanda for a year, announced that he had the answer. The team would call other departments and try to cobble the money together. Another paltry $1.5 million by cannibalizing from other budget lines. Everyone agreed. One team member immediately poked at her BlackBerry. "I'm on it," she grunted. "I know the sports marketing group can pull some T&E funds, and global marketing should be able to free up something, too." Everyone looked relieved. The best response to not having enough money for advertising? Apparently, get more money. Not having enough money is familiar turf for me, although this ostensible solution of theirs was not. I've spent my career running not-for-profit organizations that do not have a gazillion and one budget lines from which to steal dollars, so I gently stuck my toe into the boiling water and ventured some suggestions that I thought might be both smart and cost-effective. "Have you thought about using free online tools like Twitter to promote this campaign?" Silence. "Have you thought about leveraging partnerships as distribution channels?" More silence. "Maybe we could create an event or hook into a rising trend so that we can generate free buzz from news outlets." They looked at me, silently, as if I had three eyes and six arms and were the firstborn spawn of beings from another planet. Who is this weird creature? What language is she speaking? How did she get past security? So I responded to their silence with some of my own. Sitting there, I had an epiphany. I think differently. I'm not like them. Maybe I am an alien. I'm from a weird place, the land of Zilch. But I'm not alone. In fact, I don't think I'm particularly gifted. There are lots of freaks like me. We're called not-for-profit business leaders. Simply put, really great not-for-profits are brilliant at doing more with less. We understand the power of zero. We motivate employees to work past 5 o'clock with commitment, creativity, and passion totally disproportionate to their tiny salaries. We engage our board members to truly add value to our companies. We don't pay them a dime, and actually, most of them pay us. We skillfully land donors, a.k.a. customers, with an artful ask and the promise of getting almost nothing in return other than the knowledge of, and warm fuzzies from, doing something good. We manage volunteers and get them to produce amazing results, say houses or playgrounds or millions of dollars in revenue, without a competitive interview process, financial compensation, or the threat of termination. So instead of standing on my head or doing cartwheels down the center of the table in this plush corporate headquarters meeting room — I didn't want to destroy all those beautiful cookies — I decided to write down all the lessons they could learn from me, the alien not-for-profit girl. I decided to write a book, and I decided that it would have to be a business book, because that is my experience. I've run not-for-profit businesses for the past 17 years. If you're expecting a book about doing more good, you've got the wrong book. This isn't going to be a lecture about how corporations should contribute more to society. This book is not going to mention the term Zen or mission. It's not a spiritual tome about finding yourself or generating good karma. I want you to read with a highlighter in hand, not a candle. Everyone loves to talk about how not-for-profits need to behave more like businesses. They're right. We've read the literature, and we've studied best practices. I used the Harvard Business School case study on Dunkin' Donuts to help me franchise Dress for Success, which I started in 1996. We've hired great people from the business world to come lead our organizations, bringing those best practices in-house. We've even learned to charge for our services, monetize our core competencies, and create sustainable enterprises. By retracing the footprints of the for-profit world, we've learned to think of ourselves as more than just change agents. We're change companies. We're transformers. We've all watched recently as giant for-profit companies, many of them with invaluable brands and incredible histories, have collapsed. Perhaps we should call them non-profits? I've seen CEOs and COOs make executive errors and operational mistakes that no not-for-profit leader worth his salt would make. Sure, not every for-profit company is readying a bankruptcy filing and ordering cardboard boxes in bulk. But even those companies that aren't imploding seem to be slimming budgets, hunting for new and more effective strategies, and striving to squeeze just a little more productivity out of that ever smaller staff. Everyone is counting their pennies, making sure to extract value from every last cent. These are things that we in the not-for-profit world have been doing for years. And after years and years of being told that we in the not-for-profit sector need to be more structured, more profitable, more strategic, and more like organizations in the corporate world, the pendulum is now swinging in the other direction. Now, we not-for-profits have much to offer organizations that are willing to listen and learn. I started talking to friends at other not-for-profits, asking them to identify the tricks of our trade that might be useful to share. I realized that what we have to offer can be boiled down to one concept: the power of zero. We get more done with less of just about everything, from our people to our money to our workplaces to our vendors. Starting with zero isn't a problem for us. It's a challenge that we rise to every day. Zilch is what drives us to be more innovative, more passionate, more creative. Stop whining about your budget cuts and start asking yourself what you would do if you had zilch. You'll be surprised to discover just how powerful that is. I'm not going to suggest that not-for-profits have all the answers or that our approach always translates to the corporate side. We're not perfect either, but there is value for leaders of all stripes in looking at the best practices in the business of not-for-profit management. Unlike big business, we not-for-profits may not be able to grow through acquisition, but we do know how to grow through alliance. Unlike big business, we may not be able to promote people based on their experience and competencies, but we can identify employees with fire in their belly and put them in positions to blaze their own trails. Unlike big business, we may not be proficient in creating brands through research and focus groups, but we're positively brilliant at creating brands by being unique, simple, consistent, and relevant. Like smart businesses, we're going to survive and succeed by innovating and delivering results. And over the past decade, many not-for-profits have delivered outstanding, world-changing, awe-inspiring results. You may be surprised how ubiquitous and how influential we've become. And I'm not talking about our storied behemoths like the Red Cross and the Salvation Army. No, I'm thinking of some of the greatest new companies of the last 10 years. Brands that have quickly become household names and created seemingly irreplaceable products. Several of them are not-for-profits, including Wikipedia and Mozilla, creator of the web browser Firefox. Let me get a necessary caveat out of the way. Some not-for-profits are lousy. Of course they are. And some not-for-profit leaders are tired, lame ducks. Obviously. We're not going to talk about them because I didn't interview those companies and those executives. Instead, I selected an international list of not-for-profit rock stars, including Charles Best from Donors Choose, Wendy Kopp from Teach for America, Jimmy Wales from Wikipedia, Greg Baldwin from Volunteer Match, John Lilly from Mozilla, Zainab Salbi from Women from an International, and more than a dozen others. Their stories and strategies are sprinkled throughout this book alongside my own thoughts, which draw from my experience founding Dress for Success and leading the largest organization in America for teens and social change, DoSomething.org. I'm grateful to these people, not only for their time and their candor, but also for their camaraderie. It's nice to know that even if I'm an alien, at least I'm an alien with good, like-minded peers. From our shared experience, I've drawn 11 major themes. Why 11? It's a number that's significant to me because in the not-for-profit world, I like to say that we don't stop at 10. 10 is never enough. Everyone else shoots for 1 to 10. In the not-for-profit world, we start with 0 and deliver an 11. If an unpaid intern comes to me and asks how hard he needs to work to make something happen, I don't say twice or three times or even 10 times as hard. Want to succeed in this business? Then work to the power of 11 and pay for 0. Chapter 1. Do more with less cash to throw at people. For years, conventional corporate wisdom has dictated that the more you pay your employees, the more value you will extract from them. We have only to look back to 2008 to see how supremely wrong that alleged wisdom is. It was an annus horribilis. for Wall Street. Bear Stearns and Lehman Brothers ceased to exist. Firms that did survive lost billions upon billions of dollars, and billions more in market cap and shareholder savings evaporated. Yet employees at Wall Street firms still took home an estimated total of $18.4 billion in bonuses, the sixth largest haul on record. And according to the most recent financial executive compensation survey, the average base salary in that sector actually went up 3.7%. Whatever happened to performance-based pay? Here's the simple truth. Salary doesn't equal great performance or stellar productivity. Show me 10 people who truly love what they're doing and who understand why they're doing it. I'd bet that they outwork, out-innovate, and outperform 10 other people who are paid twice as much but lack this love and understanding. Historically, money has been a bigger motivator, but other factors are acquiring equal or even greater status. Frances Hesselbein, the former CEO of the Girl Scouts, who also chaired the board of the Peter F. Drucker Foundation for Nonprofit Management, says, "Few people are motivated only by money. The most motivated workers are those whose personal goals are congruent with the company's goals." Most individuals want more out of life than money. They want everything from spiritual fulfillment to a sense of personal accomplishment to the prestige of affiliation with success. Our society has changed, and yet corporations have not changed along with it. Did you know that in a recent AMP Cohn study, 77% of respondents said that a company's social commitment is an important factor in selecting a job? Furthermore, according to Cohn, Americans expect companies to adopt a socially responsible attitude regardless of economic climate. In other words, the bottom line isn't the only or primary bottom line, and money isn't always what matters most. People want to do something meaningful with their lives, and they want corporations to do something meaningful with their work. More and more people are choosing professions primarily based on passion, with salary a secondary consideration. According to a recent New York Times article, baby boomers contemplating a career shift are considering fulfillment to be a more pressing job requirement than ever. When Miriam Katowitz was asked why she traded in stock options and professional prestige for her less glamorous position at the 92nd Street Y in Manhattan, she illustrated the above point. Quote, "The 92nd Street Y is full of vibrance. You walk into the building and the place hums," Katowitz said. "It's a place that I could feel passionate about," unquote. I'm not saying that money is unimportant. It's still one of the most significant measures of success. And I like having a roof over my head, buying cute shoes, and feeding my children just as much as the next person. Nor am I arguing that being well-paid correlates with a lack of productivity. Some extraordinarily well-compensated folks have arguably earned their billions and then some. But even business superstars such as Steve Jobs and Bill Gates have publicly stated that they do what they do not to get rich and richer, but because they love it. They don't keep working 20-hour days just to make another billion. They strive to be pioneers, to transform their industries, to create new standards, to help their customers achieve their goals, and to have fun. People who take pride in what they do, and it doesn't matter if they're working on auto assembly lines or saving orphans, produce better results. The problem is that many companies don't realize or acknowledge this. They're shortchanging their people and their productivity by believing and behaving as if money is everyone's primary driver. I realize that the obsession with financial reward is hardwired into for-profit organizations. They are, after all, for-profit organizations, and I'm certainly not advocating that we abolish them. I'm proposing that corporations broaden their rewards and their understanding of compensation in a number of different directions so that people are more deeply and fully motivated to excel. Not-for-profits, out of necessity, have learned how to capitalize on the range of meanings that inspire people to work effectively. Most of us simply don't have the resources to wave big fat salaries at our staffs. There are, as usual, some remarkable exceptions. Consider the $120 million that Dick Grosso pocketed while running the then not-for-profit New York Stock Exchange, or the $12 million salary of Roger Goodell, the commissioner, essentially the CEO, of the NFL. Yes, the NFL is technically a not-for-profit organization. No legal or ethical code says that we can't pay big salaries or big bonuses. In fact, the Grosso case reaffirmed that the standard for not-for-profit remuneration is set by the board of directors based on comparable worth. The courts let Dick Grosso keep that pile of money because his board of directors determined it was fair value. However, most boards of directors and donors frown upon bloated compensation packages, preferring that the funds be used for program expenses. Consequently, not-for-profit companies typically pay more modest packages to their people. They must lure employees to jobs imbued with meaning and fulfillment. Not-for-profit employees are just as qualified and passionate as for-profit folks. In fact, what's the toughest job to get right now out of an Ivy League school? A spot with Teach for America. The pay is miserably low, yet the job is so coveted that in 2009, the organization accepted fewer than 10% of applicants. But at least the Teach for America Corps members are paid something. Much of the not-for-profit labor force is unpaid. That's right, nada, nothing, zilch. Managing these volunteers is truly a challenge. How do you motivate people if you don't have financial incentives to dangle in front of them like a fabulous dessert at the end of a mediocre meal? And in the case of volunteers, we may not even be able to hang the threat of termination over their heads. Plus, in some circumstances, like Wikipedia's gigantic volunteer labor force, the organization doesn't select its volunteers. They select us. Imagine if a for-profit company had to hire every single person who asked for a job and then couldn't use either money or threat of termination to motivate them. That's what we face. How do we do it? How do we extract the best from our people if both the threat of less and the promise of more money is taken off the table? The key to successfully doing more with your people with less money is figuring out what really makes your employees get out of bed in the morning and then giving them more of it. Produce a high-quality product or service. Don't ever underestimate the power of believing in something. People want to work on a product or service that they love and respect. John Lilly, CEO of Mozilla Firefox, the organization dedicated to producing and maintaining an open internet, likes to talk about how his product doesn't suck. That is a direct quote. Lilly believes that people may try Firefox for the first time because of its open philosophy and not-for-profit status, but they keep using it because the product is good. Similarly, the employees and volunteers who work on Firefox upgrades are enthusiastic about delivering the most accessible form of internet to the most comprehensive population. The Mozilla team believes in their product, kind of like the way a religious flock has faith in their principles. John says that his employees are looking for the chance to be innovative and participatory. The fervor is born from each employee's clarity and conviction that his or her personal seed will yield a pregnant harvest. The specific product itself is something that makes his people proud. Especially because for-profits may not offer the same noble purpose as not-for-profits, execs and managers need to cultivate internal enthusiasm for the product or service. Recognize that most people were originally drawn to your field because your product speaks to them in some way. They chose the field of advertising or making clothing or selling soap. The next step for an employer is capitalizing on and maintaining that interest. It's crucial to keep people passionate about the purpose. Your employees came to work for you at PricewaterhouseCoopers because they were interested in working as accountants. They stayed because they believe PwC offers a top-quality service to its clients. People will even take a pay cut to work for a product or service that they're proud to help create. Does your company focus solely on quarterly numbers, departmental goals, and the stock price? Is that an inspiring place to work? That focus probably encourages your employees to calculate their self-worth in terms of numbers too, that is, the pay package. Instead, focus your team on the quality of what they're creating. People want to work for a product or service they'd be proud to bring home to mom. Create a big, lofty purpose. Big, not necessarily causy. Some people join not-for-profit organizations because they're looking for fulfillment. But fulfillment can take many shapes. Some people are naturally inclined to altruism. They may be looking to save the whales or eliminate illiteracy or shelter the homeless. However, another fierce motivating force is the desire to be part of something big, something bigger than yourself. In fact, while altruism may be the bait that attracts not-for-profit employees, being part of something big is the hook that retains them. People may join not-for-profits because of our noble goals, but most won't stay with us or work at a high level unless they're getting more out of it than just a vague notion of goodness. They want to be part of something big and important, like the Mozilla employees creating more than just a great search engine, but an open internet. That's a big idea. Businesses across the board should be cognizant of this bigger-than-me concept. Employees want to work toward a goal that's immodest and broad, regardless of what it is. A not-for-profit employee may thrive on the fact that he is working to combat global hunger, an epidemic that reaches far beyond his city and into all corners of the globe. That person is imbued with a sense of purpose. What I do matters to the world. By the same token, an employee working on a shampoo product can feel the same excitement about her work, which is equally universal and pertinent. You can provide a sense of purpose through the internal dialogue you construct about your company. Instead of selling a lot of shampoo or the leading shampoo, give your product a purpose, such as washing half the heads in Brazil. It doesn't have to be noble to be inspirational. Being big can also be a source of pride. Size leaves people feeling empowered and consequently more productive. Adam Sterling is the leader of the Sudan Divestment Task Force, which works to orchestrate divestments from Sudan because of the genocide in Darfur. His career illustrates the appeal of working on something big and lofty. At UCLA, Sterling was enrolled in a course on Rwanda, which sparked his interest in genocides. He and his friends were horrified by the stories, the mass destruction, and the fact that very few people were actively trying to stop the genocide. They decided the issue was too big and important to ignore. He and his friends were just kids, without contacts or titles or an organization, but they felt compelled to act because they perceived fighting genocide to be important, significant. He and his friends hosted awareness-building events about Darfur and launched a letter-writing campaign to members of Congress. To date, they have successfully convinced 6 countries and 10 companies to divest their investments from Sudan until the genocide stops. Adam and his friends were compensated poorly, if at all, but they knew that their actions were helping to curb the slaughter of actual people. You can be part of something big, too, even if you're not saving lives or the planet. My point is that a company can position its purpose as something meaningful to its employees and make them excited about the actual function of the product or service. For example, the accountants at PwC care that the numbers they crunch be correct, because that's part of creating stronger clients. The product's integrity matters in a meaningful way, even if that meaning is different for each employee. I'm absolutely not suggesting that you place inspirational quote posters on the walls as a meaning of creating a big, lofty purpose. In fact, show me an office with a wall of posters of soaring eagles and pretty sunsets, and I'll show you employees who are cynical and unproductive. Think the offices of Dilbert and Dunder Mifflin in The Office. These posters and empty statements from management are examples of lip service, and employees can see through them in a second. I'm also not suggesting that you make donations or support a cause with corporate proceeds as a way to bring meaning to your company. It's great to donate or to support good causes, but these actions won't turn bored, uninspired employees into dynamos. Most of the time, the boss picks his or her pet charity, and that's where the money goes. And sometimes the employees feel pressured to support that same group. Yikes! This is not a positive source of motivation. This is a lazy attempt to find meaning by shifting the burden to a third party. The employees of Estee Lauder should believe that makeup makes women feel powerful and confident. The people behind Six Flags Great Adventure should feel they are part of bringing happiness and excitement to people's lives. And the makers of Purell, the hand purification goop, should rest well at night knowing that their company's product is stemming germs and disease. These are all truly wonderful corporate purposes. People will do more work for less money if they work at a place with a clear, lofty purpose. Include every level of the company in the pursuit of your purpose. One day, when President Lyndon Johnson was visiting NASA headquarters, he passed by a custodian. Although the president was there to meet with VIP personnel, the two shared a short encounter. "I helped put a man on the moon," relayed the custodian. He did not discuss his individual job, nor did he once mention brooms or emptying waste bins, because to the custodian, his purpose transcended these daily janitorial tasks. Yes, even your janitor is part of the pursuit of your corporate purpose. Some for-profit corporations are secretive with their employees about new products or feel that understanding certain corporate services is irrelevant to those below a certain level. Or they simply aren't interested in taking the time to communicate about those products and services clearly and consistently. If an organization exudes a fortified brand, its employees will subscribe to a uniform focus at every level and embody a strong sense of purpose that reminds them of their long-term impact and inspires them to be part of it. Most domestic violence shelter employees, down to the bookkeepers and cafeteria workers, know the statistics about domestic violence. In schools, not just the after-school counselors, but people at every level know why it's important to keep kids off the streets. For-profit businesses should emulate the not-for-profit sector's ability to consistently imbue staff at every organizational level with a clear sense of purpose and a belief that their individual actions will help realize the overall goal. The resulting passion, poise, and accountability would benefit any and all businesses. This is especially important for companies with offices in multiple locations. The Make-A-Wish Foundation has nearly 100 offices around the globe. The kids they help are terminally and chronically ill with a wide array of illnesses. Not surprisingly, those kids have hugely diverse wish requests. Yet every employee and volunteer at every level of the organization, from Phoenix to Tokyo to Buenos Aires, is focused on the same united purpose, granting more wishes. Not-for-profits typically do not distribute information in a hierarchical way. Simply put, we're sharers. Nothing is more enervating as an employee than sensing you're not in the know, that you're purposely being excluded or even deceived by organizational leaders. It breeds disillusionment and distrust. Imagine if the support staff at Bank of America better understood the services that the bank offers. Right now, most of its employees think of the company as helping rich people make more money. But what if the bank offered the support staff free evening classes, teaching them basic principles of finance and showing them how their work fits into these principles? Would they not be better at their jobs? Would they be more supportive of their coworkers? Would they have aspirations and dreams to achieve more? There are various ways to make sure that transparency reaches the lower ranks. New York's Lincoln Center for the Performing Arts is dedicated to providing a space for artistic performances in the heart of Manhattan. One way they do it is to make sure their employees see the fruits of their labor. When your job description includes crunching numbers or pouring coffee, the larger purpose of your work isn't smack in front of your face. Lincoln Center gets those people out from behind their desks to witness a performance, providing them with tickets and event passes. It is important for employees to see that they're part of a decision-making process that leads to something, and that their thoughts are not only valuable, but incredibly influential. When an employee who works on the playbill, for example, can see the fruits of his labor in the hands of an actual audience member, his important role in the organization becomes real. That employee goes home feeling not only more cultured, but also more empowered in his work, and he comes back to the office tomorrow super motivated. Flattening organizations is a step in the right direction, but it isn't the whole answer. Many so-called flat organizations provide a lot of insincere offers of participatory decision-making, but when important decisions must be made, and especially when they must be made quickly, they revert to old-style, top-down modes. The not-for-profit model is to find different ways to include more people in the decision-making process, as well as keep people aware of what's happening as a decision is discussed and then implemented. I err on the side of bringing too many people into a meeting rather than too few. I also have new hires shadow me, so they're at least aware of the decision-making process, the key partners, and our quirks. It's not just a learning opportunity. When people feel they're working with others rather than for them, they find the work more meaningful. A good litmus test for how well-informed employees are is whether they are surprised by shifts in decisions and directions. The less surprised they are, the more they feel they're part of the decision-making process. In my experience, I've always found that you get more with an open hand than with a closed fist. It's important to involve your people in the decision-making process. The not-for-profit world has learned that in doing so, you get more than you give. Create a physical work environment that stimulates your people. A company's offices should reflect who they really are. The walls of my office are made of glass. Volunteer Match and Idealist.org have open floor plans. That's right, almost no walls at all. The walls of Citizen School's headquarters in Boston are plexiglass garage doors, so the entire wall moves up into the ceiling with the push of a button. This construction isn't for aesthetics. It's a symbol of transparency. I ask new hires to sit in the bullpen outside my office for at least 3 months so they can listen in on decision-making meetings and learn by proximity. It's a speedy way to expose a new employee to every aspect of the company. While I'm not suggesting that every CEO erect glass-enclosed offices so that every office have a bullpen in the middle, I am advocating fewer closed-door meetings, fewer for-your-eyes-only memos, and fewer executive retreats. And I absolutely think the C-suite concept that executives should work in a space separate from their employees is destructive to communication flows. Too often, corporate offices are slickly designed but impersonal spaces. They don't communicate what an organization is all about, either to employees or to visitors. By contrast, not-for-profits rarely have too much space. More often, we are squished into tiny spaces, or we outgrow a building and figure out a way to make it work. And most of the time, it does. Working tight not only is cheaper, but also fosters teamwork, shared knowledge, and camaraderie. And like a cook in a kitchen without enough cabinet space, we're forced to focus on what is essential. Do we have bowls, plates, and cups? Too often, corporations see bigger as better. They give people perks, such as their own offices or bigger offices. They attempt to spread people out over a large area so they're not on top of one another. What they fail to see is that this policy encourages segregation and isolation. Separating employees by work levels, the executive floor, or by functions, the graphics department, makes it difficult for people to feel like they're all in it together. I'm for communal workspaces and for integrating employees who have different functions and responsibilities. Charity Water's offices, for example, could be confused for a small college dorm room. The organization strives to provide clean and safe drinking water to the 1.6 billion people on the planet in need of it. Thanks to a noisy industrial neighbor, a rhythmic pounding reverberates through the windowless space, and it's always bustling with too many people. But this situation isn't a source of resentment for the staff. According to founder and CEO Scott Harrison, its physical space reflects its priorities to spend money on building wells. That's why we're here, he says. In what sounds like the beginning of a bad joke, a construction worker and a financial analyst walk into a room. The encounter ends not with a corny punchline and a stale laugh, but in productivity. It's a typical day at Lincoln Center. The finance office isn't a group of cloaked men quietly tinkering on calculators in the basement. Instead, it's the hub of many of Lincoln Center's other dealings, from programming to construction. This everyone-in-it-together philosophy means celebrating diversity of experience and skill set. The not-for-profit world faces monetary strains that limit rent budgets and create physically constrained spaces, but these small places become arenas of diversity and powerhouses of creativity and teamwork. Space constriction should not be lamented for its crowdedness, but celebrated for its multifariousness. A space can be nurturing and inspirational because of its shape, because there is music, or because the walls are painted a certain color. People can be motivated based on where they sit, who they sit next to, and how office conversation flows. Conversely, unimaginative cubicles are like blinders on a horse, focusing them to keep their heads down and walk only where the master guides them. Is this what we want from a workforce? Whether you intend it or not, your company's environment could be limiting your productivity, morale, and consequent future at the company. Conversely, it could be a source of inspiration, comfort, and joy, a place where you envision working for years to come. Never underestimate the importance of fun. Why do so many organizations approach work with the seriousness of an undertaker? Some corporations, in fact, replicate a high school algebra class environment where talking during class, snacking at desks, and loud laughing are not permitted. All these restrictions create an oppressive atmosphere that robs people of satisfaction, even when they're doing meaningful work. Completing the assignment becomes the only thing that matters, and that assignment quickly grows onerous. Yes, at times work is serious business, and treating it frivolously can have negative consequences. Many corporate offices, however, would benefit greatly if they lightened up. Numerous options exist for increasing the fun quotient of an office, and I'm not talking about bringing in cereal dispensers and a foosball table. At dosomething.org, for example, we've turned Valentine's Day into an official holiday. I want everyone at my office to have a little love in his or her life, even if that special person is mom. I think it's important that our company provides one day a year for love. We also have an office kickball team, which costs us nothing. We didn't join a league. Instead, we send out challenges to companies we want to get to know. What self-respecting person would turn down a game of kickball? Rodrigo Mendez runs an institute in Brazil that uses art to mentor disabled youths. Many of his employees are artists, so he gives them access to supplies and provides them with creative time. He even lets them bring their children to the classes they teach, a nice perk for people who are interested in art and likely want to expose their children to it. Cost to him and his org? Zilch. Here's a simple truism that companies should keep in mind. The more fun work is, the more willing people are to go to work. The companies that complain that their people are just going through the motions or aren't committed to company goals are generally ones that treat work with the seriousness of a dentistry. Fun, on the other hand, fosters involvement and excitement, a willingness to try new things, and a desire to focus on the work rather than watch the clock. People are attracted to happy work environments, and they stay there. Darell Hammond is the founder and CEO of KaBOOM, an organization that builds playgrounds in underprivileged areas across the country. Beyond his impressive work with low-income communities, he's successfully created an enticing package for his employees. The organization celebrates every employee's birthday in a meaningful way, and it holds a monthly Peanut Butter and Jelly Day, where employees enjoy a sponsored lunch of peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. As small as these gestures may seem, their existence redefines what's in it for them, the employees. A birthday cake is a small perk, but celebrating with a second family is a big perk. A million opportunities exist to make work fun, ranging from providing employees with rooms where they can play ping pong, pool, and video games, to offering them use of exercise facilities, to scheduling events like free movies, book clubs, and potluck lunches throughout the day. My office has very silly bake-off competitions. One day, employees are challenged to make something square, and another day it may be something that includes fruit. These non-compulsory team-building activities cost us nothing but add laughter and camaraderie. Offer skill development. What could be more valuable than helping employees develop new skills or acquire new knowledge? Skills translate to greater career success, either in your organization or somewhere else. In a world that is increasingly knowledge-driven, the chance to acquire expertise in a critical area can make a huge difference in an individual's career. Not-for-profits possess numerous options to help their people acquire skills and knowledge, from providing in-house classes to paying for seminar and workshop tuition. Some have formal job switching or apprentice programs. People are keenly aware that knowledge and skills are the foundation of great careers, and having the chance to acquire some of both can make even a mundane job meaningful. In my office, I have created a kind of guest mentoring program. Periodically, I bring in thought leaders and innovators for one-on-one sessions with my people. The other day, for example, Katarina Fake, founder of Flickr, the first and largest photo-sharing website, it was purchased by Yahoo in March 2005, spent about an hour sitting with my chief technology officer, getting to know him and offering thoughts on our website redesign plans. George Harrick, one of the first dozen Google employees and the guy who led the team that created Gmail, has also spent time in our offices mentoring our CTO. Recently, our two content writers spent an afternoon at the CNN offices with a Pulitzer Prize-winning producer. No specific agenda, just a chance to share experiences and ask questions. Not-for-profits know how to reach out to experts, not just to make our organization stronger, but also to facilitate our people's growth. Nearly a dozen thought leaders have come through my offices, spent unstructured time getting to know our people and programs, and offered advice. It's a terrific, priceless perk. For-profit companies bring in big-name speakers or entertainers, usually at a high cost. But do these people spend time in a small format with anyone other than senior executives? Tell Jimmy Buffett to leave the guitar at home. Instead of entertaining the Time Warner holiday party, wouldn't it be more useful for him to spend an hour getting to know your editorial staff, explaining his creative process, and exchanging best practices on writer's block? Dole out titles liberally. People often define themselves by their job titles, and it costs nothing to give them a title that suits them and makes them proud. Most for-profits tend to rely on a stock group of titles. You are a product associate, and then a manager, and then a director of product, and eventually, you hope, an EVP of product. There's nothing wrong with these titles, and they're exactly how some people want to define themselves. People aspire to the higher title, so why not give it to them? You can confer vice president status on people without spending a dime. Better yet, you can make up a new title that makes employees feel valued. Is that person really a communications manager, or is he the manager of buzz? Jerry Yang was famously not the CEO of Yahoo, but rather the chief Yahoo. The title itself can inspire people to think differently, think bigger, or feel appreciated. I've given business cards and titles to interns and volunteers, and it is amazing to see them network a room with pride and hold their heads just a little bit higher. Of course, if you give everyone a title, the importance is diluted. A title has to reflect the employee's talent and worth, not just the employer's appreciation. So give a fitting title. Spend 10 minutes crafting something relevant and appropriate. Not-for-profits have discovered that people often view themselves in highly specialized and sometimes idiosyncratic ways. For this reason, one employee may prefer to be called head donor strategist or innovation specialist or team builder. My title is actually CEO and chief old person. And I appreciate the humor in it, which sets the tone for our office culture. Titles offer people a sense of identity in the workplace, and finding the right one, and not being locked into traditional titles, is worth the effort. One not-for-profit friend of mine thinks that a title's tangible representation is even more meaningful. Having the title emblazoned on an office name plaque, or even creating an award that explains it, can be significant to people. Not only does it remind them that they have been recognized for their contributions and knowledge, it communicates their worth to others. As people enter an office, they can refer to the plaque to orient themselves and pick up the tone of the office. Remember that accomplishing goals feels pricelessly good. I have two employees who are semi-professional long-distance runners. Some have difficulty appreciating the mindset of people who run just for the sake of running, not to put a ball in the end zone or to train for a tennis match. These guys simply love to set goals and achieve them. At work, not surprisingly, they are motivated by the same quantifiable goal setting. Some people like being able to see a number on the horizon and then overshooting that goal. It makes them feel good or useful, part of a team, even if that number is meaningless to the overall organizational purpose or any other team member. Some people are achievement junkies and need to push themselves to the next level, like running an under 4-minute mile. So set a goal for them and then help them achieve it. To such people, it's more satisfying than receiving a financial bonus at the end of the quarter. But asking my long.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.